burnt offering. And each of the parts has significance and has spiritual significance. In the Old Covenant, in the shadow, they took a, for example, the burnt offering for the camp was two lambs, one in the morning and one in the evening. And you would take certain parts, and there were certain parts of the sacrifice that were more focused on and more involved with when it came to the burnt offering. And one of those parts we want to begin to talk about tonight is in Leviticus chapter 1, and verse 9, and that is the legs. Verse 9 says, "But its inwards and its legs shall he wash in water, and the priest shall burn all on the altar to be a burnt offering, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord." And verse 13 almost repeats the same thing. And so, what is the spiritual significance of the legs? Well, in the Old Covenant, the sacrifice, as I said, was a bullock or a lamb or a goat or, you know, and you literally just, your involvement was with an animal. But in the New Covenant, our involvement is with the Lord. And the legs speak of our walk. And in this case, since it is a daily sacrifice, it speaks of a daily walk. Now, I know a whole lot of people whose Christianity really shows up on Sunday. But this is, we're looking at the legs, which is not something that just shows up on Sunday, but it is a daily walk. And it is speaking to us that our daily walk should be as a burnt offering, that we should be offering up Christ to the Father on a daily basis in our walk, not just in our service, if you know the difference. One is our service can relate to ministry and what we're doing in ministry. But we're talking about how you carry yourself outside of the church, how you walk, how you live your life before family, before friends, before the world, on the job, this sort of thing. So we continually, daily offer Christ as to how we satisfy God. In other words, again, constantly clarifying this, you don't satisfy God by offering your stuff. You satisfy God by giving him the acceptable sacrifice, and that's Christ. All of your commitments and things that are nothing more than you giving yourself and thinking that that's what God wants falls short of the acceptable sacrifice. So, if you're going to live a life that is well-pleasing to God, then it's going to involve a regular, shall I say, at least in your heart, regularly being brought to the altar. Now, let me just clarify something here when I say stuff like that. You can hear a lot around this place about death, but only for one reason. Life comes out of death. If you put a seed in the ground, it dies. Life comes out of it. If a forest is burned, if a great forest fire burned that forest, it'll come back with new life. Life comes out of death. If a star implodes and goes supernova, it will produce countless numbers of new stars. Life comes out of death. I would say it like this, even. The goal is life. But to get life, it takes death. Josiah played a song for me and eventually bought me a CD by David Crowder. There's one song on there, one little portion of a little bit of a song. He knows right off which one, I'm sure, maybe he doesn't, but I when I heard it, I just went, yeah. He said, and then the song starts out like this, and he just hits a chord and, you know, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. I don't think so. No, I remember how it sounded, and he sounds a lot better, but thank you. But now think of that, okay? There is a physical manifestation of a spiritual truth. The physical manifestation is everybody wants to go to heaven, but you can't get there unless you die, if you understand the concept, right? Well, that comes from a spiritual truth. That everybody wants to reach a certain level with the Lord, but nobody wants to die. But there is life out of death. Can you believe that? But it does take faith. It does take faith. But folks, you can't sit around all your life wanting to go to heaven unless you're willing to die. And you can't sit around wanting the real things of God, the things that spawn from life and that are not just put on, like much of religion, like much of the church, just put on, just faked, just, you know, I could go on and on about the concept, but that is so not Jesus. No, but everybody wants something real. They want power, they want life, they want to affect people's lives, but nobody wants to die. You see what I'm saying? We're talking about the burnt offering. Nobody wants to lose of themselves to gain Christ. So, let me say, when we talk about death like this, and you can't get around it when you're talking about the burnt offering, the goal isn't just death, 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 death. The goal is, and Paul described it like this, death works in my mortal flesh, so then death works in me, but life in you. In other words, in his case, that's a death worketh in me. That's an ongoing process. He was a continual burnt offering, which is another name for the burnt offering, continual burnt offering. He was a continual burnt offering, but life was coming into all these other people. And we cannot be a continual burnt offering, and we can get splurges. Anybody ever had a few splurges of life, you know? And then you go back to the dull living of your life, you know? Man, I'd rather have Jesus than me. And when you get to that place, now some people would rather have them, but I'd rather have Jesus than me. When you get to that place, death is not so ugly. You would not get to that place and say, death, death, death. Everybody's talking about death. Why are you always talking about death? I want life. You would say, death, death, death. Thank you, sweet cross. You'd go up to the cross and you'd kiss the cross. You'd see that the spirit that brought Jesus to the cross, you would kiss those nail scars in his hands, and you would see them not as ugly actions of murderers, because Jesus wasn't murdered. Jesus laid down his life as a living, as a sacrifice, right? As a sacrifice. He wasn't murdered. They didn't murder Jesus. Jesus gave himself for us. And let me just say this too. If Jesus is going to be formed in you, it's not all going to be miracles. I mean, thank God for miracles. And let me say this again. I hadn't said it in maybe a while. This place could not exist without miracles almost daily. Anybody ever watch the offering plate on Sunday morning? You just go, how in the world can this thing survive? And you would think with the way it goes Sunday after Sunday, somebody would jump up in front and go, my God, people, we've got to give. But we don't do that. Why? Because we believe, we don't just believe in miracles, we live by them. Thank God, thank God. And we exist. Because I want to tell you how easy it would be for God to make this place go away. Just, that's all it would take. And we're just hanging by a thread and have been for, a lot of years. But, so, I do believe in miracles. I believe in healing. I believe in the gifts of the Spirit. I believe in the power of God in relationship to gifts and miracles and all that kind of stuff. I believe in it. I love it. I like it. I like it. I love it. I want some more of it. But I love Jesus more. I love Jesus. I like miracles. I don't know that I love miracles. You know what I mean? I don't know that I'm in love with miracles, but I love Jesus. Man, I love Jesus. And it's not just I love him for what he's done to me, does in my life. The way that he is so different than the way I am that I would like this self-giving one to live in me, and I'd like to see a little proof of the living God. And I'd like to see it right here. And if you want that, I'd like to see it in you, but it's not something I feel led to shove down people's throats. You know what I mean? I'm going to teach it. I will always teach this. But it's not something I feel to shove down someone's throat. It's something I feel that only those who have gotten to a place where they're just going, man, I'm fed up with life and I'm sick of me. They just love this kind of Jesus. They love to hear about it. They don't go, death, death, death. All you ever talk about, Randy, is death, death, death. They go, preach it hard and fast, bring on some more so that I can enter more fully into his death with the result of more life, because it always ends in more life. If there's a death, if the death is with Jesus, there's what we call resurrection. Okay? So, I just felt maybe to clarify that. I haven't done that in a while. And you can get lost in some of the things I say when I'm teaching could be really scary. And could make someone go, thank God nobody else in the world teaches like this, so I'm going to go run to the other teachers or whatever, and that's good. But the cross is just a door. It's a door unto more Jesus. And I want more Jesus. And not just me. I want the world to have more Jesus. Just for some of you that have been around here for a while, you probably have thoughts that I have, Well, where's the resurrection? We've been in death for a while here. Where's the resurrection? And then I realized I probably never told you that when we went into the death, I said, Lord, don't let the resurrection come up in us. Let it come up in someone else. I should have told you that. Because you're going, come on now, it's about time. The season's about ready for. And I said, Lord, it's kind of like store it all up, store it up, store as much up of the death up as you can, and then release it on someone else later on. So that it'll be a bigger release of Christ instead of little releases that we're siphoning off and going, oh, praise God for our. you know, do you understand? I mean, it's like I really would rather, let's just sort of let something big happen someday, even if it never touches our lives, but I failed to get your permission. So I just wanted you to know what I've done for years now and what I've been believing for, and that's why things aren't hopping around here and all this, and we're not seeing that. It's not because we're wrong or messed up or whatever, and that's, well, no, we are wrong and we are messed up. There's no question about that, so let me not say it like that. But that's not what's at work. What's at work is God is going to get a bigger release of Christ in this earth by our willingness to stay down and dead and out. And so just pray for me. The Lord will change my mind and how I pray. But I'm fully on board with this way right now. All right. Well, anyway, hopefully some of those things have at least, you know, if it hadn't clarified something, maybe it's, you know, giving you insight into the mind of a criminal. how ex-criminal, yeah. Yeah. You know, as far as everyone else, yeah. Well, you know, sadly, I still notice ways to break into banks and stuff, and I still see that, and I'll tell my wife, and then, you know, and I'll go, why does this come so easy for me to notice these things? Oak Cliff. All right, continuing on here. This burnt offering, Christ, is offered in our daily walk and is one of experience and not knowledge. There's such emphasis on knowledge. And folks, there is a necessity to see these things, but seeing them is not the end. Seeing them, if I can say it like this, seeing them is the door to living them. And there are some places and some people who teach just the seeing of it, and nobody ever lives it. It's just that we all know deep stuff. I don't want to know deep stuff. I'd like to live as the body of Christ, where Jesus can actually come out of us. Oh, the wonder of Jesus coming out of his body. You don't see it much. And I want to see it more first here in me. So it's a thing, one of experience. It involves how we offer Christ to God. The burnt offering, the legs, the inward parts. It's not a random thing. That's why you must see it first. It's not a random thing. You just don't go live as a Christian, whatever that means to you, and it means something to someone else, it means something to everybody, just sort of roams around and says, I'm a Christian. And, you know, it's sort of a Christian, it's kind of like a, what is the table where you play pinball? It's sort of a pinball, and balls are shooting out of there, and all of a sudden a Christian pinball comes up. And you shoot it, and, you know, the only difference between it and the other pinballs is it trusts that its life is going somewhere. No. The whole purpose of the book of Leviticus and other things, but the book of Leviticus is giving specific ways God says, yes, I want Jesus, but here is how I want him to be given to me. That should be an eye-opener to us. That should say God wants more than Jesus. He wants Jesus in a specific way. All right. It's not that Christ was crucified and so we are made conformable to his death. It's not about us being offered up, but we bear in our bodies the dying of the Lord. And it says that. We bear about in our bodies. See? Now, let's just take a second to think about that thought. Do you hear that in most churches? That we're supposed to bear about in our bodies the dying of the Lord Jesus. Do you ever hear that anywhere? I've never, and I've been at this for a lot of years. Folks, these offerings are shadows. The real thing is supposed to be happening in the church today. we're supposed to be bearing about in our bodies the daily sacrifice of Christ. Him not doing what he wants when he wants. You remember what Jesus said to Peter. When you were young, you went wherever you wanted to, when you wanted to, and how you wanted to, and whatever. He said, but when you got older, others girded you and took you where you didn't even want to go. But you know what? When he says you didn't want to go, it just means Jesus said, you know, save me from this, you know, cross, but nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. There is our soul, and then there is our heart for the Lord. I experience this all the time. I can tell a difference between my soul and Jesus living in my spirit. What is the difference? The difference is when Jesus lives in my spirit, he says, let's do this to the glory of God, even if it means death. But my soul says, I don't want to do it. Get me out of this. This makes me feel bad. This makes me look bad. I don't want this. No, no, no. And yet it says the sweet savor offerings are to be a willing sacrifice. And I'm, you know, it would be like God taking a lamb and saying, okay, we're going to put you on the altar. And the lamb starts going, no, and starts backsliding, you know, backsliding heifer and kicking and going, no. And can you imagine a lamb doing that? Trying to grab hold of it and hold it down. And you're going to the altar for the glory of God. Well, that's my soul. It does that. But in my spirit, I want what the Lord wants. And so the goal is to get out of my soul and get focused on the life that is within me, that freely gives himself to the Father. That's what, remember, maybe you don't, but that's early on, that was what we identified as part of what the sweet savor sacrifices were all about, was they were not a offering for sin, but the offering of one who does it out of love and willingness. Well, I'm telling you, that's only Jesus. Ultimately, that's only Jesus. You'll commit for a while, if you're like me. You'll commit for a while, and then you'll start backing up. But by Christ, we can do these things, but only by Christ, you know. So part of the process is recognizing, you know, recognizing the need for the dying of the Lord Jesus at work in us. The burnt offering daily is more than you going through the same pattern as Christ. It is more than just teaching and more than just experiencing patterns. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ, and Christ lives in me. That's more than teaching. That's living reality. I mean, if we, how many of you can honestly say, you know, the last 2 days, everything I've done or most of what I've done, that was Christ? I got one hand. Well, okay, you're messed up. So am I. What is the conclusion, though? That we're messed up and we ought to just slap ourselves? No, we should slap one another. No. No, the conclusion is we need Jesus. And you know what? If we all recognize that, then we need one another. Right? Because you're not going to make it there without the rest of them. Jesus even said, he called them by twos, he sent them out by twos. And in the Bible it says, you're walking along and if one stumbles, the other's there to pick them up. Folks, we need one another. We don't always recognize that. We're usually focused on our own needs. But we need one another. And I promise you this, if you're going through something hard right now, when it gets cleared up, somebody else is going to be going through something hard. But they never knew you were because you didn't tell them. And one reason why we don't tell them, why? Because we don't want anybody to know how really messed up we are. Well, you're all the same. You're all messed up. We are all messed up. We are. It's just sort of everybody gets a turn. But if you can just open up to one another a little more, don't be afraid to ask somebody just to pray for you. Here's the simplest thing. Just go to somebody and say, you know what, I'm really messed up. I need Jesus. Would you pray for me? What do you think they're going to do? Oh, my God, you're messed up. You're not like the rest of us, perfect. That's ridiculous. They're going to go, yes, I'd be glad to. You know, I would love that myself. I think I'm going to try this method, you know. So that the life of Christ can be formed in us. Obviously, we haven't reached perfection yet. Obviously. So let's keep going. Let's keep encouraging one another. All right. Jesus is not patterns, teaching, or the presenter of ethical standards. If you think about, for example, the Sermon on the Mount, those are not just ethical standards. If they were, then for the Son of God to come down here and be able to live it, I'm trying to draw you a picture. The Son of God comes down here, and he turns the other cheek, and he goes the extra mile, and he does all this, and for him to live it is no big deal because he's God. Can I get an amen on that? Then what kind of tyrant turns around who's God and can do it and then looks at flesh and human failure and says, now you do it? That's a tyrant. That's not, folks, that's not good news. That's bad news. That is bad stuff. That's not a benevolent God that would do that. That is a mean-spirited God, unless the same one who can live it tells you that, and then comes back and lives it in you. Now that's what I'd call a good deal. You know, they call it good news. I'd call it a good deal. You know, that's a good deal. I can sign up for that one. Jesus didn't come to give us ethical standards. Is his teaching good? Yeah, but it's worthless in my life if I'm supposed to live it. Maybe it's not worthless, but I'm worthless. The law is holy, just, and good, but I'm carnal, sold under sin. Huh? The problem isn't the standards. The problem is the life trying to live it. So what does God the Father do? He says, I will father you by putting my Son in you. The one who can do it. What a sweet father. What an incredibly sweet father that would put his Son in us and then call us son. Praise God. Thank you, Father. All right, so for man to copy Christ's action would be like monkeys trying to copy God. You know, go to the zoo and say, okay, monkeys, be like God. You know, praise him, praise him. You know, you're going, okay, it's going to take a little more than that. Okay, look, for example, look in Romans chapter 6. And keep your place there. Because we keep going back to Leviticus, but if you would, Romans chapter 6. As much I could allude to here, most of you know what Romans speaks about. If you could remember everything Romans speaks about, then this verse would mean a lot to you. Verse 4. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death. Oh, that's what I was going to share. We are buried with him by baptism into death. I'll finish this in just a second. But I was going to share this earlier, and it slipped my mind. Or my mind slipped. Recently, when I would go through this Jesus in me soul wrestling match, I know what is the truth. I know the life of Jesus. I know the Lamb. But I get off into focusing on the problems and on this and that. And every time I do, it's like a grease slide. You just start slipping and you can't stop it. You get to a certain juncture and you can't stop it. You're just sliding so fast, you're going, oh my God, it's out of control. I got too far down the slide. You know what I mean? And, whoa, Lord, I want to, you know. And the Lord gave me a picture that has helped me since then. Been just really honestly over the last couple of days that has helped me in this certain area. And it may not mean anything to you, but it was based on this scripture. We are buried by baptism into death. He showed me a picture of the Father baptizing me, not in water, but into the death of Christ. And he showed me the Father, you know how we usually do, Jim, we hold them, you know, they're like this, and then we usually will take their nose if they want us to, and, you know, lean them back into the thing, and if you've ever done it before, you feel their weight going back, and that's where you bring them up and everything. He showed me a picture of the Father taking me down into death. And at first, I was just flailing, like, man, I was fighting the death. And he just said to me, lay back into his death. I know that's probably too simple, but it was, you know, it was just right for me. It was like, just lay back into the death. And I felt my muscles that were so tight relax. And I just felt his arms all of a sudden. You know, before I couldn't feel his arms. In fact, they were enemies. This is sucking me under. These arms are pulling me under. You know what I'm saying? But I could just feel the strength of his arms. And he said, just lay back into the death. And I could just feel him laying me back down into it. And as I went into it, and that's as far as I've got so far, I'm in it knowing that he's the one who brings me up. But that I'm going to accept the death of Christ. I'm not going to flail and fight it, because it's working for more of Jesus and more people. And so, for whatever that's worth. Now, that really wasn't what I was shooting for in this verse. That simply reminded me. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, not into water. This isn't talking about water baptism here. That, as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. In the Spanish Bible, it literally just says we should walk in new life. Okay. Notice it didn't say that we have a new walk. It says we walk in new life. What's new is the life. Yes, it is a walk. But what's new is not a new walk. God didn't just save you and then give you a new walk. That would be you. He gave you a new life, and with that new life comes a new walk. We're talking about the legs being offered in the burnt offering. So the walk of Paul was in new life, not a new walk. He did not offer God his own legs. He offered Christ's legs. Isn't that interesting? Having trouble walking the walk? I remember my stepfather, who was an alcoholic almost all of his life. When I got saved, the first thing he said to me when I tried to witness to him was, if you can't walk the walk, don't talk the talk. His first thing he said to me. It was his way of getting me off his back, but it actually made sense. You can't walk the walk, don't talk the talk. Well, I couldn't walk the walk with my legs. But we're not offering God our legs. our walk. We're offering God the walk of Christ in us. Again, the sweet savor offerings relate to life and experience, not a death 2,000 years ago, but a living experience with Christ on a daily basis. Even 1 Peter 2:21 says this, leaving you an example that we should walk in his steps, not walk in our own, not walk in our own legs. Can anybody admit it? That maybe you've been trying to walk this walk. Or to put it in another way, you've been offering God your legs. And God's seen Jim's legs and he don't want them, man. Well, I don't want them legs. Let's not get Cassie started. She'd jump in this one. All right, we walk the walk of the burnt offering. When Jesus walked, he offered himself, right? But his example is fulfilled by the acceptable offering in us. Paul would present nothing of himself as acceptable unto God. And that takes some work for the Holy Spirit to take us through some things to get us to the place where we will offer nothing to God but Christ. Where we're past trying to give him something that's unacceptable. This is why Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who empowers me. The word there, strengthens me, really is the word, it comes from that word empowerment, meaning he's the power. I can do all things through Christ who's the empowerment of my life. Yeah, I can do it. But without that empowerment, I can't do it. And not only that, I not only can't do it, many times I just don't want to do what God wants. Do anybody ever get discouraged thinking about yourself? I'm just a failure. Anybody ever think that thought? I am a failure. Here I am. God's blessing me with good food, good teaching, good this and that. And I just don't even want to do it. You go through seasons of that. I don't even care. You're still okay. You're still okay. As long as you discover that it's not your will in the sense of your willpower. Amen? It is that you do this through the empowerment that is Christ in you. Then you have hope. But if you're discouraged or if you're fed up with yourself or whatever, that can be really good in the Lord, or it can be really bad for you. It can be good in the Lord if you are able to trust or at least believe. I remember, I'll just say this before I make that statement. I remember one time when, I told you the light at the end of the tunnel was a train. I remember where there was no light at the end of the tunnel. I remember one time where everything looked hopeless. And it was so dark and had been so dark for a while that the only help I got when I read anybody's book on the purpose of troubles and trials or the purpose of suffering or this and that, I got nothing out of them. Why don't you say something? Why do you write a whole book and not say anything? I need some help here. And I remember the only help I got was simply a breathed word by the Spirit who was almost like passing me by, that's what it felt like, I'm not staying. You're like Lazarus. You've been in the grave 4 days. You stink. But it was simply this. Can you just have hope that something might happen? And that was about all I could do, was go, well, I can hope. I don't have any basis for hope, but I can hope that that this isn't the end of the world. That life as we know it has ended. But there is actual, and that's all he asks. He says, well, look, I'm not trying to build your faith right now. Can you just believe that I actually could work something out of this? Even if the devil and all of his demons are in control, can you still not hope, have a little hope that I could still do something with this whole thing? And that was the first thing I got that I could hold on to for a while, long enough that till I could see a little, you know, a little blade of just little slight green thing go ping up out of the dirt, you know. You go, oh, there is life, there's some, you know, and you're going, life, you know, and where's fruit? Where's what? I don't care, there's life. You know. All of a sudden you're not so wanting everything to be so perfect and whatever. You're just glad to have a little life for a change. It was just the fact that God could do something with all this mess held me for months. Well, I don't know if anybody's discouraged, but I keep harping on this, so maybe the Lord will use some of this stuff. When Jesus walked, he offered himself. Paul would present nothing of himself as acceptable unto God. If the acceptable offering was not the power behind the act, then Paul would have none of it. The acceptable offering being the power behind the act, meaning I can do all things through Christ who is empowering me. And the fact, not the empowerment to do what I'm doing, is the doing is holy, but the fact that the source, the empowerment that when I do it is Christ, that it's Christ, that's what's acceptable. Isn't that hard to comprehend? We think, like with the board up here with no chalk thing or eraser or drawer or whatever, we think that if I drew a thing here, that's a bad thing. Now draw this. Now you do that, that's a good thing. Now draw that, that's a bad thing. So there's only good things and there's only bad things, and all you got to do is figure out the good things and then do the good things. That has nothing to do with any sort of change of from your life to his. It's like you're crawling all over the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, only picking the good part off of that tree. Only picking the good off of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. No act in itself, including giving your body to be burned, is holy in itself unless the eternal spirit, that lamb nature, that wonderful Lord of all, Jesus, is the empowerment behind it. That's the acceptable sacrifice. Then what you've done is accepted because it's come from the one that is accepted. Does that make sense? And you know what? That can mean not speaking up. And instead, in other words, you would think just speaking up and saying something and doing good for a bunch of people, that's the Lord. But he may tell you to keep your mouth shut and not do anything, but that's the Lord. But nobody would know that it's the Lord. They would just think, why aren't you helping? And crucify you for it. You know what I'm saying? And you're going, look, I am determined not to know anything but Christ and him crucified in this vessel. But people are looking for certain acts that are honorable and that are holy. And they're not looking for Jesus. So I'm saying, you know, look at Jesus. He went in the temple and made a whatchamacallit, and drove out the money changers, beat them. I could see somebody, maybe somebody in this very room or watching or listening to this, I could see somebody standing there in the temple going, this is God's temple, and looking at what Jesus is doing and saying this, that's not Jesus. No, that is Jesus. Go over and ask him his name. That's Jesus. But we'd say, that's not Jesus. Jesus would come in here, hand them the thing, and tell them to beat him. No, not necessarily. The goal is Christ in whatever form he manifests. The goal isn't to always lay down your life. The goal is to have the life that lays itself down functioning in you. Let me give you another example. Lord's on to something here. I don't know who, what, where, but the Lord's on to something here. Let me give you an example. My wife used to think that the Bible says, wives, submit yourselves unto your husbands as unto the Lord. So my wife used to think, okay, that meant anything I said, she does. Whether she liked it or not, submit yourself to your husband. So it does not matter. That's the will of God for my life, and that's what's acceptable. So one day we were talking, and this seemed like it had been a couple of years into our marriage, and we're talking, and she says, just sort of in passing, it was sort of not really being brought out in the conversation, but she said to me, you know, I didn't really agree with the decision you made on that, but she wasn't confronting. It was sort of like in passing, she was just, it had just slipped out. And I said, wait a minute. You didn't agree with that? And she said, well, I didn't mean, you know, I wasn't in rebellion or anything. I said, well, why didn't you tell me? And she said, because the Bible said, wives, submit yourself to your husband. And I said, do you know that you failed being the kind of wife that you're supposed to be? Because here's what that means. It means, as a head, I can't make all the decisions until I've got all the pieces to the puzzle. I can't make the right decision. If I got one piece and the puzzle's got five, I'm in trouble. You know what I mean? My chances of getting it right is pretty slim, especially with me making the decision. But God gives you a wife to give you another piece, and for you not to accept that and just say, well, whatever, you know, my wife spoke, so that's not it. That's not it at all. But that you have a wife that can say, okay, well, here's what I feel might be the Lord, and here's the proper way. Deb would say to me, here's what I feel might be the Lord, but I'm the wife and the weaker vessel, and I may not know clearly, but I know that you want all the pieces so that you can make the decision. And you may reject what I'm giving you, and I'm not giving it to you to be accepted, but because you want all the pieces of the puzzle, and so I'm just submitting this to you and want you to make the decision, and I'll go with you no matter what, but I know that you respect me and you want to hear another piece. Anybody get that? And that's exactly what I believe it is. And you know, sometimes, so we started walking in that way. And so sometimes she would share something and I'd go, well, I don't think that's the Lord, but I'm going to pray about it. I'm going to take special interest in it because God gave you to me, and that might be a very important piece that I need in this whole thing, and I may not be seeing it, so I'd pray about it. Other times she would submit her piece, and I'd go, man, that's the Lord. Man, I've just gone, oh my God, that is the Lord. If you hadn't have spoke up, I would have made a terrible mistake. Does that make sense to anybody? You know? Well, you know, as a wife or as a Christian or as someone in the church, doesn't mean you blindly do anything your husband says or the leader says or whatever. If you have a piece, you need to bring it. But you don't bring it going, this is my peace and bless God, you better honor it. See, that's the wrong spirit. You're already wrong. Even if the peace is right, you're wrong. But you say, look, I don't know. You know, you're going to hear from the Lord. You're supposed to be the one that sees in this. But here is what I feel. And then you say, you know, I tell you what, this, for some reason, I know that I am talking to wives right now. Let me tell you a little secret about husbands. One way to really get them, one way to really get a man, a husband, I mean, not go after and find get to them. The way to really get a man is get online. Not really. God help me. Where did that come from?
You don't know. Yes,
that's exactly right. Nor will I ever try to get a man online, I guarantee. There's some advantages of being Texan. Sorry, now I'm embarrassing myself. One way, God put within men a sense of responsibility before God, because the scriptures say the head of Jesus is God, the head of man is Jesus, the head of the woman is man, the head of the children is, you see that? There's an order. God set that up, and he put this thing inside men that if you put it just right, they will feel the responsibility before God. But if you don't tell them the stuff, if you don't tell them their responsibility, not that you're forcing them and you're not manipulating them, but you just say, you do it just like this. Honey, I know that you hear from the Lord, and I know you'll hear from the Lord in this subject. And so here's what I feel like I heard from the Lord. This responsibility rests with you because you're the head. Am I right or wrong? This kills a guy. You know, the responsibility rests with you before God. I mean, you know, you'll be the one to stand before God. But I just want to... I am telling you, you leave that in a good spirit with a man, they feel God now all of a sudden. Now the weight of God is this is no longer, they could hide behind the wife and the kids and everything else, but now it's them and God. And they feel it. You do. I mean, see, you, as a girl, you can't fully understand that. You can't fully appreciate it, but a guy does. That weight comes down on him big time. He goes, oh, my God, no, I need to, you know. And before, he might have made a decision what he wanted and run over the top of you. Am I right or wrong? But now that pressure, not pressure that you put, but the responsibility of the order that God put, that makes him go, man, I got to hear from God now. I mean, like, really? You know? So anyway, I'm sorry, guys, I'm giving the tips away here, but it does work. I've seen it over and over and over and over. It works. All right, let's see. I'm running short of time here, so... Well, since we're getting short right here, I'll just finish with this. This life of the burnt offering is not us. It is Christ. But what we're going to see in the next class, we're going to get into a whole nother phase. What we're going to see in the next class is that the sin offering doesn't require anything. It can happen 2,000 years ago, and all you got to do is say, I believe in it, and poof, you're in, baby. But the sweet savor offerings, like the burnt offering and the meal offering and the peace offering, they require personal involvement. It's not just Let me just say this. Maybe for the sin offering, you can use the term believer. You can just be a believer. I don't know that that term is ever really used in the scripture. Maybe it is. I don't really remember offhand. Just being a believer, because that just means you believe stuff. Man, we're more than believers. We're sons of God by Christ. We are in the family. We have the life of Christ within us. And when it comes to these sweet savor offerings, this is like a meshing into our life. This is how we live our lives. This is all of these offerings now are part of who we are and how we carry ourselves. We are priests of the living God. And we'll see that in the next section as we get into this real hands-on reality, depending on where you are at spiritually. Not requiring everyone to be at the same exact place spiritually. And we'll get into that. Okay, let's stop and we'll come back for the next phase.